Okay. Our argument is that we don't think that is there are more pressing needs at this time of COVID that we need to address. We have to deal with questions of recovery from the impact of COVID. We have to deal with questions of health arising from the lockdown. Okay? We have to deal with our international commitments in matters that relate to, for example, health. And so it doesn't make sense to start thinking of security when we cannot see, when we cannot even smell that security at this point. So we believe that let money go into areas that are very important to facilitate recovery, to ensure that our people live a much better life. Now, in terms of, for those of you, Ismail Lado has raised the question of the court judgment on what we popularly call Petition 16. And we had dragged the Attorney General to court, arguing that, you see, by not providing adequate resources to health, you are violating the right to health of citizens of this country, based on our international commitments and based on our own constitution. And so, and the Constitutional Court agreed with us and said, yes, it is actually wrong not to provide adequate financing for health. What is sad, that the judgment was delivered over a year ago. What is sad is that the government has decided to look the other way and has not taken into consideration this judgment. And we believe that by doing that, through the ministerial policy statement, through the budget framework paper, we believe that government is in contempt of court. That is our contention. And I don't want to preempt some actions, but before the end of this week, those of you who patrol the, who know what happens in this town, will actually know the actions we are going to be taking against government. Because we believe that it is in direct contempt of court. The Supreme Court made very clear recommendations. One, adequately finance the health sector. Secondly, prioritize maternal health. But if you do an in-depth analysis of the current ministerial policy statement, you'll actually see that they have decided to do the opposite of what court asked them to do. Okay? And yet, our contention is that we cannot argue that we don't have money. The question for Uganda is that we are not prioritizing. Our priorities are upside down, and that is what we need to deal with. And that is exactly what we are calling on Parliament to do, to reprioritize and know what exactly the people they represent want of their government. People of Uganda want to go to a public facility and find drugs. People of this country want to go to an education facility and find fair education. Okay? So that is what we expect Parliament to do, to stand with the people of this country and demand for what rightly belongs to the ordinary person there, their ordinary voter. As they pass the budget, they must think about those people they have left behind. Each of those votes that contributed to their coming to Parliament, they must think about those people. And that is where they should take their decisions when they are in Parliament.
Thanks. Financing basically is just a replacement of an existing debt with a new debt, but with favorable terms. So now, if government is moving towards that approach, that means government has realized that the debt that was previously contracted had very bad terms. Now they are moving to another, they're taking up another step. So like we go and renegotiate the debt that we have with favorable terms. And once that is achieved, that means we shall be freeing some resources. It may not be much based on what the negotiations are all about. So there will be some little resources that we could save from these processes. Because currently, if you look at domestic debt refinancing, it stands at 8.5 trillion. So it's still a huge amount of money. Yeah. Thank you.
As we speak to you, we believe that you convey the messages to people who, as CSOs, we are not able to reach through your different media channels. So we appreciate you coming around. My issue also, to emphasize on what my colleagues have been talking about, is the issue of actually whether this money, remember we represent the citizens as CSOs, as in the populations and the masses out there. So it's so disheartening to feel like you people actually pay taxes from your incomes and you want services which are basic to be provided to you, but to some extent you don't see what you're paying for translating into what you have been, you know, contributing to. So our concerns are not only
so we are calling upon the government, one, to consider retooling and skilling UNBS to scale up the decentralization of services by opening and keeping regional offices instead of being based in Namanga only. Two, to set up more common user facilities which will reduce on the cost of doing business since they are certified. This will enable the informal traders meet the required standards, ensure food safety and reduce post-harvest losses among for farmers. We have a concern around the inadequate funding for rural and urban water supply programs in Uganda. We note that the budgetary allocations for rural water supply and sanitation is projected to reduce by 54 billion, while urban water supply program is also expected to reduce by 544 billion. This is despite the fact that an additional 55 billion is required annually to increase water supply coverage throughout hard pumps and solar powered mini pipes water in rural areas. Also, the urban water supply sub program has unfunded priorities totaling 40 billion. So, how are we going to address the increased need for water if the budgets are reducing this much? Therefore, as CSOs, we say that if the government intends to achieve Sustainable Development Goal SDG number 6 by 2030, which is about improving water coverage and access to safe water and clean water in rural areas, the government needs to match its talk with its allocations, fund improvement of water supply systems, especially for rural areas, which have the worst context in terms of access to safe water in Uganda. We are concerned about the delays in passing the National Disaster Preparedness and Management Bill. The process of developing the legal framework for the National Disaster and Preparedness Management Bill began in 2019 with the formulation of the bill. However, up to now, the bill has not been finalized. Currently, the bill awaits to be presented to the Parliament. The absence of a law has created a big gap, yet the National Disaster Preparedness and Management Policy provides the basis for the formulation of a comprehensive disaster management legal framework. We recommend that the Parliament should expedite the process of finalizing the development of the National Disaster Preparedness and Management Bill so that we are better able to manage disaster. Of course, CSOs are concerned about this issue because evidence shows that when you don't have a proper framework for managing disasters, periods of disasters usually form the worst periods for accountability in a country. People shift money quickly because they're doing emergency procurement, so a lot of money is stolen. We have a concern around the inadequacy in funding and programming for gender-based violence and sexual gender-based violence in Uganda.